So how you been since the last time we spoke?
Yeah, I've been good. Just away on my little island. Had a nice little break from content, which has been quite good for me. I was definitely stuck in that role of, scopes and then filming and then refilming and then editing and, getting them out there, and they would proliferate the internet, but then it was just a bit of a grind. So it's been nice to slow down and, do some research and be in nature and have a little break.
Yeah, I see you're in nature a lot and you're talking a lot about food and the ripeness of fruits and you're there with your feet out. And but for the people on Rumble that don't know, because I'm not sure how many people remember our last collab, can you give a little bit of a backstory?
Sure. So my name is Shannon Michaela. Before the pandemic, I was a professional contortionist and street performer and traveling around the world. And then obviously the arts industry was completely crushed. So I started posting on TikTok and on social media. And now I just create content and work online mostly. I would say my content is a mix between acrobatic archery, kind of, I do a lot of spoken word, talking about the agendas and the hidden things that are at play in a very subtle way. And, it's kind of a wellness, there's a lot of wellness ties to my content. And yeah, it's a fun little circus.
So what do you think
Yeah.
about feminism for people in here who don't, what's your take on feminism?
Yeah, so I made the viral video, Feminism is a Scam. That kind of went all across the internet. It's pretty self-explanatory. I called out feminism. I came from that arts background, so very left, a little bit woke, and the pandemic just completely woke me up and made me aware of the masculine and feminine dynamics and how they are at an attack, as well as the family unit, and how from the inside out the movement has been hijacked to cause this social disrupt, and maybe the ties towards feminism had that initial reaction when the movement was funded by the Rockefeller families. And I really go into it, but yeah, that was the context to the Feminism is a Scam video.
I think people like you, I end up seeing when I watch your content that well, a lot of there's a certain demographic of people that fully align with a lot of the same beliefs. And I've been watching your Instagram story. You talk a lot about satanic worshiping and how people are plugged into the matrix. And you talk about how like even I like how you are even critical about Elon Musk. Like people are celebrating him. A lot of people who believe in the truth, but people like him are promoting Neuralink, where they're literally plugging your head into a fucking a brain chip like that. I don't support Neuralink at all, and I'm surprised that so many people who are talking about red pill truths and are talking about how they're trying to destroy masculinity and promote femininity to destroy the family are actively worshiping Elon Musk when he's trying to get us plugged into the metaverse.
When you have that reminder at the forefront of your brain, it kind of seems obvious, but yeah, something a little bit particular and unusual about that plan, I think. I certainly won't be getting it. Will you?
Absolutely not. Absolutely
What
not.
if it gave you superpowers? What if everyone else, all the other cool kids, were getting it?
No. Well, I forgot you're on Instagram Live right now, so I'm not sure how much we could. I don't want to get you banned, so I can. I on Rumble over here on Rumble, we could talk about everything when it comes to the jib jab, when it comes to the election. We could be really honest about here, but I forgot you're streaming over there. But eventually, you should come over here so we could really get into it. I want to hear your full conspiracy beliefs about that. But if you remember the last time we had you on my stream, you shot the arrow with your feet, but you missed the target. You want to try again?
Once. I mean, my setup's a little bit out there. I'm not too keen to, be bending over backwards for you today, Sneeko.
What? Okay.
I was definitely in the mood, Sparks are flying. I wanted to show you all my tricks, but today's a little bit more casual.
More
We'll have a
casual
little
and
bit more of a
chill.
conversation.
Yeah, sparks are
I was
definitely
gonna
flying
ask
that day.
you.
What are you gonna ask me?
I feel like I have a million questions for you because you have just been on this like really unique journey of, kind of being extracted from these matrix type platforms. And yeah, I find what you're doing really interesting. But you mentioned Rumble and how you can speak so much about anything on here. And I just wanted to ask you if you think that you know, Rumble will eventually become more censored compared to what it is now, you know, as they get more investment, as they become bigger, as these bigger players come to the platform, do you think that it will eventually like reinforce the same censorship kind of woke little
I've been thinking about that too. Eventually, money corrupts, power corrupts, and eventually people have to fold. But for now, I know the CEO. I talk to him pretty regularly. I'm going to go meet him in person pretty soon. He is like all about the fight against big tech. Shout out to Chris Pavlovsky, I think that's his name. He's like, I need soldiers for this fight. He wants the right type of people. And that's why we need more women on Rumble, because it's all just dudes like, the Great Reset is happening, talking about, it's really political, like all these people. And we need more content creators, just more people to keep it more of an even level playing field, because everybody that's going to come to Rumble is like, yeah, big tech, Matrix. And so it needs to be some level of entertainers on here too, or else it's just going to be those type of people. Eventually, I do see that becoming a possibility, but not for at least 10 years. If that does happen, I think it's inevitable with any platform, but I think Rumble has a good 10 years of being the place where free speech can really take place. I can't hear you. I can hear you now.
I said that's fair. Did you have the same relationship to people on YouTube and on these other bigger platforms? I mean, I was just thinking about like the process about, you know, you get banned, like, do you have the option to appeal? Are you speaking to like a human during this process? Or is it just like, you know, you're banned, that's it, automated robotic replies and
there's
that's
no,
it?
There's absolutely all robots, all emails. You have violated community guidelines for misinformation by. There's nobody I can communicate to. I have the Rumble CEO's number. It's pretty cool to be able to like, yo, what's up, Chris? The CEO of the website. But there's absolutely like Susan, she definitely knows who I am because I got a nudity strike. Yeah, Susan, the CEO of YouTube. Yeah, I have some tasteful words for her, but maybe I should tone it down and not be as... But anyway, she definitely knows who I am, but they don't have any type of communication. They want it to be very corporate, very robotic, even though they are watching and there's somebody... Well, when I was on YouTube, there was somebody behind the scenes pulling the strings, deleting the videos, demonetizing me, age-restricting my content for absolutely no reason, giving me strikes for no reason, there was someone behind the scenes doing that. There was a point where like every video, like randomly when I would say tasteful words about the CEO, they would randomly just demonetize a bunch of videos at once. Or when I was like talking, when I went to Bucharest and I was with Andrew Tate, they just randomly age restricted a bunch of videos on my main channel that wasn't even my streaming channel. It felt like they were just communicating with me through the system behind the scenes. The level of communication with YouTube was them just censoring me as much as possible. But there's nobody behind the scenes. There's nobody I could talk to. Even though I've made the millions of dollars and I've been on the platform. Well, I was on the platform for 10 years. I got that million plaque. There's nobody. They just gone. Poof.
So are you Sneeko, the human, the reptilian? Are you like banned from the platform? Or is it just like the channels, the individual channels? And, you know, you have the opportunity to restart and, you know, abide by their rules and do the right thing. Or are you just like, it's you as a person?
It's me as a person. Sneeko is gone. I'm not allowed to create. Once they ban you, you can't create a new channel. I am capable of making a collaborative channel with somebody else. But for now, I just really want to push Rumble. Fuck YouTube. That's the way it's just like, if they don't want me on, I'm not going to go keep trying to be on. So fuck them. Like there's no point in trying to do it. But I respect people who are doing their thing, but it's just, there was a time where I was trying to get back on. I was trying to sneakily stream and sneakily like go on different channels, but they banned all the fan channels too. There was a channel like, yeah, they banned three of my channels, Sneeko Lit, Sneeko and Sneeko. And they even banned like this channel called Simply Sneeko. Chat, talk to me right now if you had a fan channel that was terminated. So many people, they popped up on my Discord. They were just trying to just wipe me completely and act like I didn't exist. And now my whole existence on that fucking sense, like that Matrix platform, it's all just documentaries just saying negative things about me. The only existence that I have on that platform is just like, I'm a misogynist, I'm an anti-Semite, I'm a piece of shit, just straight up like the demise of me, calling me insane. It's all negative. So I really want to make sure that Rumble can grow so that there's a place where I can exist and just be myself and not be and like the demise. He went into his Joker era. I still want to exist and not just be a reptile, as you said.
So bad. Have you thought about creating your own platform? You know, the sneaker site.
Yeah, I have that. I posted my 1 minute podcast, my most recent one, on my website. It was on the Creativity Kit. That's where I post a lot of my videos, and that's where I have a course and everything, and that's where I posted a lot of my main channel videos. I'm slowly going to release some on Rumble, but yeah, I have my own website. But I think it's better to have a platform that has a collective ideology, and I really believe in Rumble. I believe that this website has the same ideological alignment of what's going on that you and I have, that a lot of people who realize the truth have. So I believe in this. I want to be on a place where other people, like, part of the benefit of being on a website is there's people who don't know you. You know, if you just go to your website, it's just going to be your same fans. I like having discourse. What I really liked about being on YouTube was people disagreeing with it in the chat, and there being an active discussion, people in the comment sections arguing. On Rumble, pretty much everybody already agrees with me. So that's why I want to have more people, and so there could be active discussion. If everybody agrees with you, then it's boring.
Yeah, I understand that.
I like your background. Why does it look like it looks like a Gaussian blur? What program is this?
Oh, I just did this through Zoom.
Oh, okay.
Oh, not through Zoom.
Through Discord.
What are we on now? Discord. Yeah.
That's cool.
Yeah, it's not the nicest background, so I thought it'd be good to have a little blur.
Have you found your post-apocalyptic boyfriend yet?
I found a couple.
A couple? A couple at once, or a couple since the last time I talked to you?
No, there's certainly a lot of post-apocalyptic men, women, theys around me. You know, they're all there. It's all a community. I found lots of pals for the apocalypse.
Oh, okay. So you're not in an active relationship with them. You just met a lot of those people.
Yeah.
Okay. Good.
What about you?
I guess. But yeah. Yeah.
Sneeko, what about Brett?
Don't talk about my wife.
So I posted on my stories, does anyone have any questions for Sneeko while I jump on the stream? And one of the most asked was like, just tell him straight up, is it you or is it Brett?
Come on, Shannon. You know, don't let what me and Brett have get in the way of what we have.
There's no getting in the way. It was just a question, really.
Just a question. Well, me and Brett, we
Brett.
You guys go way back.
Don't worry about it. Don't worry about Brett. She can't even. She doesn't even compete with you. So don't worry about it. It's okay. You guys should collab, though. I think I creeeped the fuck out of her.
I really liked her. And she's doing some cool stuff.
How did you become awake again? For the very few females that are watching the stream, what do you think made you realize all the brainwashing? Because one of the things that really made me like your content was the fact that you used to be a blue-haired feminist. You used to take birth control, used to be hoe phase type girl, and then you realize a bunch of that stuff. What made you realize that?
Drastic change, to be honest. Like you said, you know, I got on birth control quite young, like when I was still a teenager, because you know, hormones or whatever, and you don't realize until you're off it that, you know, your body's going through such significant changes, and, you know, the anxiety that comes with it. And yeah, I think getting off birth control definitely like switched my hormones into place, but that was just one part of it. So yeah, I was coming from the arts community. I was very like in that woke culture, you know. I noticed with a lot of like arts projects, the ones that get funding are those that, you know, have like a woke kind of message interwoven into the like circus or, you know, the arts industry, whatever. So I really definitely came from that background. And I was super like angry at the world for no reason without realizing that, you know, I'm in the most privileged position right now. But yeah, I think the ultimate switch came from just the pandemic. You know, I mean, things became a lot obvious. I obviously started questioning like the vaccines and what was going on and who was actually, you know, pulling the strings. And, you know, just it all kind of came out. And, you know, my dad's pretty onto it, so he was always kind of dropping little bits and pieces into my consciousness and encouraging me to think for myself. And at the time I reconnected because I moved home. I was traveling around the world, you know, performing. So coming back to where I grew up, I reconnected with a lot of old friends who were, you know, thinking about these things and having these conversations and, you know, just asking me, like, you think you're a feminist? Well, like, what? What does that mean? And it's like, I actually didn't have that, like, self-reflection or those conversations with people who had opposite views with me. So coming home and having those conversations really, like, allowed me to, you know, do my research and get pointed in different directions where you start learning and having, yeah, these different opinions. So, yeah, the pandemic, friends, yeah.
Can you tell me about that movie? You said that you wrote a script and for the chat to explain what script are you working on and what role do you want me to play in that?
So I wrote a script for us to read out so that we could hopefully do a little collab post just about masculinity and the war on it. And I honestly haven't read it in a little bit because I read it a little while ago. But yeah, there's obviously and evidently a war on masculinity at the moment. And you know, I was going to ask you in particular, like, what do you think it's going to take for people to
wake up,
reactivate that masculinity and, you know, embody this character? Like, what is it going to take?
One sec. My camera's about to cut out because I'm a bad streamer. Before I answer that question, can you describe the most unattractive traits in a man? Because I have a mostly male audience and we were watching and we saw a couple white knights, a couple soy boys pop up. What is a red flag for you when you see a man who doesn't embrace his masculinity? What are the telltale signs? What should you not do as a man in 2022 for everybody who's getting brainwashed by this woke ideology?
I think that it's important to go back to these old, like, expectations, you know? Like, you see a lot of feminists getting mad at people for, you know, opening the door for you or really, really pushing to, like, you know, pay 50-50 in a day. And it's like, if you are having these interactions with people and you are connecting on them in a romantic level, then, you know, you kind of need to be met more than halfway. But what's a red flag that I see guys doing? You know, just like the way there's a, like, when a guy is talking to you like he's another guy, I think that's a bit of a red flag to me. Like, they don't have that like awareness that you are like this beautiful female character in your life, and if they're just treating you like one of the guys, that's not good. In terms of the work though, I mean, just when somebody's weak, when somebody can't like take charge, you know, if I'm interested in a guy, I want them to, you know, help me with these decisions. I like somebody who can they say that you want a man to like provide, but it's not just like financial support. It's not even
provide
like, solely about that at all. Yeah, emotional support. You want somebody to like guide you and lead you and help you with decisions and make plans and be that strong figure that wants the best for you. So if you're shying away from that, then or letting the woman, you know, step into her masculine to compensate for you being too much in your feminine, then that's going to come out and, you know, throw things off.
I don't think that there's going to be a massive shift in people awakening their masculinity. I just think it's going to be the survival of the fittest. And that's why I encourage a lot of men. I'd be in my stream doing push-ups, telling people how to get money, how to improve themselves, and how to figure out women and just become the best man you can be. And people in my stream realize that most men won't make it. Most of the divide of the rich and the poor, the successful and the brokies, it's going to become bigger and bigger. Inflation is getting stronger. You invest in crypto, right? A lot of people are preparing for the future. And if you don't prepare for the future now, then a lot of people aren't just going to make it. I think, I don't remember who said it, but somebody said there's going to be the have-nots and the have-yachts. Everybody in my stream, I want people to get to the point where they can be have-yachts. So I tell people, start making money now, get in shape, prepare for the future. It's going to get worse. There's going to be another disease coming up. And you can see what's going on in China right now. They have like little tents and everything. Like they have... They are still COVID testing everybody. They have like, they're literally on the highway. They have QR codes that you need to scan your vaccine passport in order to pass on the road. You see that level of control in China, and you wouldn't even expect that whatever happened in the, everything that happened in the past 2 years in America would have been inconceivable 20 years ago, 10 years ago, and it happened. So what's going on in China right now, I think you could see that, and you could probably predict that it's going to happen in the West too. So we just need to become as rich, as strong, and as prepared, and as unplugged from the Matrix as possible, because not everybody will make it. And that's why I'm streaming on Rumble, because not everybody's going to make it to this website. Most of these people are going to be watching. You know who's, I've been talking about this whole stream. Number one trending right now was Shane Dawson, a guy who was literally like kissing little girls and kissing little boys, doing disgusting things, was outed as a breadophile. You can't say that on Instagram. Was outed as a breadophile. And it's just the fact that he is being promoted number one trending is like, what the I'm banned for misinformation, and they're promoting these people, these disgusting people. James Charles isn't banned. Ethan Decline isn't banned. And he said that Ben Shapiro should die in the Holocaust. Some, like him and his family, he would want them to die in the Holocaust. Nobody called him anti-Semitic, but they call yay anti-Semitic for calling out the powers that be, for calling out people like the Rockefeller family, people who hold all the wealth and hold all the control. Those people are getting banned, so we just need to wake up and realize what's happening. Not everybody will make it, and we need to just start preparing for the future. But no, I don't think that there's going to be a massive awakening. And even a lot of girls like you, my chat's right now saying that your smile is infectious. I see the way you're here. It's contagious the way you are. You're here, and you're like that. You've fully embraced your feminine nature, and most women now will think that that's being weak. But it's really powerful the way you are. It's radiant, it's vibrant, and a lot of women do not embrace that, and so they become really combative, they become really argumentative. They try to become like men, and it's weak to act like that because they're unhappy. But you've been smiling this whole time. You rarely see women, every time I've seen you, just have this infectious smile, and I'm just here like, yeah, you put people in a better mood. The whole chat likes it.
Just say something about that, too. So I finished school and I was so angry at the world. I didn't want to be perceived, you know, I was in my feminist kind of world. So I literally cut my hair to here and, you know, I wasn't shaving and, you know, I just didn't take care of my myself, you know, my physical image, because I was just like so angry at the world, you know, blah, blah, blah. I don't want guys to, you know, treat me nicely or make these comments. So I'm just going to make myself ugly. That was like my version of rebellion, and I made my life so much harder. And that's not a bad thing, because now, you know, now that I've kind of gone on the other side, you know, I'm taking care of my health and I'm really like looking after my image and I'm making an effort to, you know, work on my mental, spiritual health and to just be positive and, you know, obviously authentic with my emotions. But yeah, people definitely treat me a lot better now that I'm like authentic and happy in myself and taking care of it. And that's not a bad thing. You know, it's not a bad thing to step into that, and, you know, you don't need to fight against that. And yeah, I kind of went through that phase. I went through a really, really rough phase, just like cutting my hair and, you know. And
growing, you had the big ass armpit hair and shit.
Yeah. Well, why would you not want to, you know, just take care of yourself and, you know, enter the world?
Because you want to rebel against gender norms or whatever. Can you describe to me what your ideal man is? Because right now I see a lot of guys in the chat and they have this idea that women only look for physical appearance when they are seeking a man. But I think that's more of male nature to objectify. There's some people in here I have a lot of people who would say they're black pill, which is this idea that if you're not 6 feet tall, if you're not extremely good looking, if you're not like the perfect standard of a man, that you should just give up and that you can never get a woman. And I'm saying that's I personally disagree with that completely, but what is your ideal man? What traits and what characteristics are you looking for? Can you inspire some incels that are watching the stream?
Yeah, it's not good to get caught up in the whole, you know, you're not short. I mean, if you're short or if, you know, you're just, you know, not 6 foot tall, it's not a bad thing, you know. I personally look for somebody who is like healthy, somebody who takes care of themselves, you know, someone who's working out a few times a week, someone who you know, is drinking quality water, somebody who is, you know, getting their produce from fresh Dasani sources, people who are health conscious.
Can I drink Dasani water?
The Saudi water?
What? Dasani water. Dasani?
Dasani. I've heard that brand isn't very good. Dasani. No. Oh, okay. You know, someone who's fluoride free, someone who's embracing nature, somebody who is like business oriented. You know, I personally don't, you know, I've kind of dated, you know, the hippie guys that are kind of rejecting money and all of that. So that's not really my thing anymore. You know, I want somebody who is business oriented, who is health conscious, who, has an appreciation for nature, who has a desire to learn and is constantly, seeking out knowledge, somebody who's intelligent. You know, all of these qualities are attainable by everyone.
How much do you look for, do you think that physical appearance is a deciding factor, or do you look for more of the characteristics that you just named?
I think I've been attracted to people based off their energy and, you know, what they're doing in the different, you know, avenues that they're exploring in their life. But, you know, I've also been attracted to people from like a surface level. But, you know, having a deeper connection with somebody, and, you know, you need to, you know, kind of have a little bit of both, I think, to have an awesome relationship or to explore that with somebody.
So you were dating those hippie guys, like the white guys with the man bun and the little shark tooth necklace, you know, a little bit of chest hair, and the guys who meditated before sex and shit like that. And like, money is just a concept, and they were broke as fuck and just talking about yoga and meditation. So that was what you were attracted to beforehand when you were a feminist?
A baby girl, so I've dated a wide range of people, but I've always been kind of drawn to more like alternative guys, I guess, you know, especially where I live. Like, I live coastal, there's a lot of like beachy, surfy, nature kind of guys around here, and I guess I'm a little bit of a hippie too in nature, barefoot, so that's always kind of what I've been gravitated towards. But you know, you want somebody who's like, you know, aware of the matrix and who is using the matrix to their advantage. You know, you can't just be completely out of the system. Like, you need to use it in order to get out, otherwise you're just going to get stuck in it, you know?
So you like alternative guys because regular guys are boring?
No, I'm not even saying that I like alternative guys. I'm just saying in the past that I kind of dated that like hippie archetype. Yeah, all the qualities that I look for before aren't necessarily like central to like, you know, an alternative guy. That's kind of not what I'm saying. Does that make sense?
No.
So in the past, I used to date, you know, that hippie archetype, and now I'm after somebody who has the qualities that I described before.
Okay. When do you want to have kids?
Soon.
Okay.
You know, I mean, I think really in the past year, 2 years, I've, you know, become really aware of, you know, the family unit that's being disrupted and the importance of the mother and, you know, creating children that are, you know. So does that make sense? As like a woman, you know, I have a high value on children and raising the next generation. And that's something that I never used to be tapped into, but now, yeah, I definitely am. And yeah, I think it's a high priority. I've been learning a lot about birth and the birthing industry lately, actually.
Oh, you're going to have the kids in a tub type shit? They're going to be floating out of the tub when they're born? You're one of those?
You know, maybe. I've just been learning about home births, because I would always have people commenting in my DMs, you know, saying, when are you going to make a video about climate change, for example, or this or that? And one of the topics that kept coming up was like the birthing industry and how medicalized things have become. And, you know, I've been learning about how so much of that hospital birth situation is like traumatic, and you know, we have this collective trauma from these hospital births where women are being, you know, injected with these harsh drugs, and you know, the cesarean rate is actually only 2-5%, but in America, in Australia, it's like more than 30% now, because there's this like financial incentive to, you know, have these cesareans. And you know, as a result of that, you're not really getting that bonding time between the child and the mom, and then, you know, because of that, you know, some people can't have create breast milk, so you know, you have these kids on formula, and you know, we just have this huge like collective trauma from the birthing industry that I've been learning about. And obviously I've been so gravitated towards that because, you know, I'm a woman and I care about, you know, fertility and health and families. And yeah, I had no idea about all of this until like recently, so I've just been really learning about it.
I thought, what do you about the women who want to enjoy their 20s and be independent and don't want to have kids until they're 38?
Fine, but you know, the risks certainly go up. You know, you don't want to leave it too late and then, you know, become infertile, or, you know, our fertility rates are already dropping. So, I mean, obviously you want to choose a partner that you actually, you know, align with, and, you know, you can't just be, well, in my personal belief, you shouldn't just be, you know, popping out kids with people who you don't see like a serious future with, but.
Right. Yeah, people, you want to pop out kids with guys that you've like talked to, you know, hypothetically like on 2 Discord calls with or something like that. Like, that's who you would want to reproduce with. Somebody who you've talked to, like, twice on Discord, or like streamers. You fuck with streamers?
Oh, only you, Sneaker. Okay. Yeah, what about you? Do you have kids?
Yeah, let's have you. Yeah, you want to? No. Oh, no, I'm just joking. Yeah, I want to adopt.
Do you? Why?
You want to have twins?
Oh, I don't know about that. I don't have any twins in my family.
Yeah, of course I want to have kids. I'm not sure. Who?
I think having twins on like the first round would be a bit much. You know, you want to have a bit of practice with a kid. Just like one to get the hang of it before you start popping out twins, for example.
I don't know. I think I got twins in me. I think that's just what's going to happen.
When do you want to have kids? Just out of curiosity. How old are you now?
I'm old enough. I'm grown.
Oh, are you still with your partner?
My who? Partner? That's your gay.
Your partner.
I told you to stop asking. I told you to stop asking about Brett. You don't need to worry about her. You don't need to worry about her.
Okay.
But I think soon, within the next couple of years.
There's like a new wave of people, you know. Lots of young people are coming out and saying, you know, I actually don't want to embrace hookup culture. I'm actually done with Tinder. You know, I want to settle down. I want to have families. I value my fertility. I value raising the next generation. There's like a huge wave of people that are wanting to, you know, create families. And yeah, I think that's really powerful. And it is
happening. Is there a huge wave of people who are doing that? Or maybe your algorithm is just showing that because that's the wave that you're on right now? Because I'm telling you, the rise of Tinder, OnlyFans is getting crazy. Even some of the biggest streamers get a breakup and then immediately their ex-girlfriend downloads OnlyFans and posts that shit up. So I think it just depends on the type of content you're consuming. If you are in that phase right now, so you're probably seeing a lot of that. I don't know if that's the case. And also, it's pretty funny that people will just like fuck a bunch of people on Tinder and then eventually get bored of it. And like, now I want to start a family after catching 50 bodies in 30 days.
Yeah, it's fun. I mean, you know, I think people are waking up though. You know, it could just be my algorithm, but yeah, I am feeling inspired by seeing so many young people, you know, embracing this path, and you know, more and more people are talking about it. More and more people are realizing, oh, it's not just me. I'm not just alone for feeling this way. You know, there's other people that want to embrace this lifestyle too. But yeah, everyone comes to their conclusion in their own time. You know, some people genuinely just don't want kids. Yeah, there's people who claim, you know, online that they just don't have that maternal instinct. But it's kind of interesting how common it's becoming for people to be deciding that they don't want kids. I just, you know, it's... I would think that it's like in our natural biological instincts to, you know, create children and create families. And like, if you don't, is that some kind of like hormonal thing, or like, are you on the pill and that's why you potentially feel that? Or I don't know. It's kind of interesting.
They're training it right out of us.
Mm.
They're training it right out of us. Before we leave, cause I have more guests coming on. Do you remember can you teach me another stretch or something like that? I've been sitting down for 3 hours now. I want to go get loose. I want to be all embracing my nature. Can we stand up and do some stretches?
But yeah, we can just do a little bit of stretching.
All right, here we go. I'm following your lead.
I have one more question for you, though.
Yeah.
Well, we'll just do some... This is a pretty cool standing desk.
Oh, you were standing all the time?
Yeah, it's a standing desk now. So we'll just do a little bit of wrist, because you know you've been probably typing, doing this, doing that.
Yeah.
I was gonna ask you a question, and then you can kind of do the shoulders as well while you're doing that.
Okay.
So do you think that the more people that speak out, the more that is going to be allowed on these platforms and going the other way? Or do you think that, you know, they're just going to keep cutting off people, cut banning people, and then the level of censorship is going to, you know, go down? You can do hand circles as well.
Well, Elon was a good step in the right direction, but selfishly, I'm actually hoping that more people get banned so that Rumble could keep blowing up. And then a lot of the viewers that I lost on LTube will come here and I can get the same viewership that I had before. So selfishly, yeah, I hope more people get banned. I hope more people keep trying to speak the truth so that a website could take over that will destroy these big tech companies.
So who do you think is next?
You.
Me? Nah. I don't say anything too bad.
You know, selfishly, who has two strikes, and I was really selfishly, I hope he doesn't get mad about this. If Speed gets banned off of YouTube and he's banned on Twitch and he has to come to Rumble, it's a wrap. Think about that whole generation of kids that's going to come here.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. It's pretty, yeah, it's pretty wild. I've been thinking a lot about the kids and, oh, I don't know. I just got stuck on a YouTube little rabbit hole watching old kids TV shows and then watching kids shows, from, you know, this generation and how, like, dumbed down, mind-numbing they have become.
I don't... You watch kids' TV shows for fun?
No, it just kind of came up. I started watching... Well, I guess I did, you know, started watching stuff from my childhood. You can kind of get your spine waving from left to right.
How the fuck you look like... I can't do that.
Listen...
What the f- Yo, can you do that? Can you do that spider crawl thing that freaked me out?
Not a really good space here. I've got lots of stuff on the ground.
Don't worry about it. Okay.
Next time I'll warm up and we'll have a fun time.
Oh, we'll have a fun time?
Yeah.
We can have a fun time off stream too, right?
You know it's Nico.
Okay, Shanna, thank you for coming on. I think we need to continue this conversation off the stream because it's getting a little hot in here. So we'll talk soon and we'll get all ready. I feel nice and stretched out. It was good to see you again. Send me that script.
Yeah, definitely. Thanks so much for having me on your platform and yeah, enjoy the rest of your evening.
Okay. Love you. Love you. WL chat. What? Chat, it's No Nut November. Relax. It's No Nut November.
That's
your job?